I know you're all here to talk about the Working Families Flexibility Act. I'm excited that this bill has come to the floor and that the speaker and the leader and the chairwoman have been so supportive, even carried this bill a few times herself. This is an amendment to the Fair Labor Standards Act that allows for workers in the private sector to do what work hourly wage employees in the public sector can already do, and that is utilize the benefit of compensatory time in lieu of cash payments for overtime. This bill is very simple. Congress cannot legislate another hour in the day, and if you talk to hardworking moms and dads all over this country, a lot of them will tell you that they value time more than they do the cash payments for overtime. Again, public sector employees can already do this. Look, our workforce has changed and our policies haven't kept up with that. Just 50 years ago, only 30% of moms worked outside of the home. Today, that's over 70%. So we have a lot of issues that I know you're going to talk about today, whether it's health care or tax reform or funding our government. But while we continue to work on those very important policies, this is something that we can do to demonstrate to the American people about how we care about the need for flexibility in the workforce. And the Working Families Flexibility Act does just that by giving hourly wage employees in the workforce the ability to utilize paid time off, compensatory time, if they choose to, in a voluntary agreement with their employer. Only if the employee wants to utilize this can they under this bill. So again, I appreciate the leadership here, the speaker, the leader, and of course, Kathy's. No one has been a stronger advocate for family values than Kathy. So again, look forward to this bill coming to the floor today, and thank you.
Morning. I want to highlight some of the important things that are in the funding bill that is coming to the floor this week. A couple of things. First, this puts more boots on the ground to bolster our border security. In fact, this is the biggest increase in border security funding in a decade. It provides more resources to combat the opioid epidemic, which is a high priority for Republicans here in Congress. It expands the school choice program. That's something that many of us feel very passionately about. It expands the D.C. School Choice Opportunity Scholarship Program. It maintains our pro-life protections. It contains no new money for Obamacare, no insurance company bailouts. It takes major increases in defense spending while holding the line on non-defense. This is something that I think is really important that people are sort of missing in this really important story. I cannot understate how much of a game changer this is. I used to negotiate budget agreements with the Obama administration. Under President Obama, Democrats insisted that an increase in defense spending be tied to an equal increase in non-defense spending. You want to help the troops? You want to help the military? I need just as much money for domestic discretionary spending. That was the Obama rule that we lived under for 8 years. They insisted on this even as our military plunged further and further into a readiness crisis. Well, we got to a point that our Air Force pilots were going to museums to find spare parts over the last 8 years. We got to our point where some of our planes are so outdated that whole fleets would qualify for antique license plates in Virginia. This forced parity that we lived under the Obama years really constrained our ability to rebuild our military for this century. This appropriations bill changes all of that. No longer are the needs of our military going to be held hostage for increases in domestic spending. This means that we can finally make real important strides to increase and improve our readiness. It means we can get our service members the tools and the resources they need to confront the threats that we face all around the world. Well, we have a lot more work to do to rebuild our military. This is a very big first step. $25 billion year over year for our military, and you do not have a corresponding $25 billion increase in domestic spending, which is what Obama would have requested and required. That is not here. We broke this parity, and we think this is a really important step in the right direction. The first responsibility of our government is national defense. Under President Trump, we are truly putting that first. We are excited that we're honoring two big priorities, a big down payment on border security and a big increase for our military so that they can do their jobs.
Good morning. You heard from Congresswoman Martha Roby and from the Speaker. This is a very big week this week. We have a lot before us. But I want to give a lot of credit to Congresswoman Martha Roby on the Working Families Flexibility Act. She is an attorney, she is a mother, she is a congresswoman, and she is a wife. She knows the struggles that every other constituent faces with. She's listened time to her constituents and everyone across this country. They want more flexibility. Time is a part that you can't add more to, but what you can spend more time with, on the needs of a family or a loved one and others. And why shouldn't the private sector have the same rights that government does? In 1978, government actually allowed this to go in place. You can work overtime, but the worker can decide how they would like to have either pay or comp time. Think about if somebody in your family was sick or in need to be a certain place. I think it would improve productivity and actually improve the work ethic of where we're going in this country. And I want to thank her for continuing to fight for that, and Kathy for all her work with it as well. The speaker laid out when it comes to the omnibus and the funding of what we have fought for so many years for when we watched our military be decreased. Well, we will look around the world, and the world is not a safe place. But this is an exceptional country. The world is safer when America leads. But if our military does not have the resources to be able to do what they need to do at any given moment, the world becomes very unsafe, as we see from what's happening around today from North Korea, Syria, and beyond. This funding bill actually provides that. It is a first start. Also, that won't be the only thing that we do this week. When we look at the great menace of North Korea, there will be a sanctions bill on the floor. The sanction bill will make sure that North Korea sanctions cuts off access to international ports, authorize sanctions on companies and financial institutions that do business with the Kim regime, and targets the regime's use of slave labor. I think when you look at the final week of where we're gone through, from the funding, from the investments of where we need it, from strengthening America's moral values across the world for those to see, and more importantly, looking for individuals to be able to have more time and choice and flexibility in their own workforce.
I'm looking forward to a busy week this week, and starts with the work that Congresswoman Roby has done to give more flexibility to families in the workplace. It's something that she's been pushing for, and a lot of other members have been pushing for a long time. And as the leader said, it's only fair that if the government employees have that kind of protection and flexibility, why shouldn't workers in the private sector have that same ability to choose whether or not they want to spend more time with their family when it comes to overtime rules? So I think this is an important reform and a strong pro-family piece of legislation. When we shift over to the government funding bill, obviously our first priority and our constitutional duty is to protect this nation. President Trump has made it a strong priority too, and this bill reflects it with $25 billion of increased defense funding. And when you look at where it starts, it respects our troops. The largest pay raise for our men and women in military in 6 years. And I think that's an important step to reward them for the hard work and the sacrifices they're making to protect our freedoms. When you look at some of the other reforms in this bill, it actually reduces spending in areas where we've seen government run out of control over the last 8 years, starting with the EPA, bringing the EPA down to their lowest spending levels since pre-Obama being in office. And so that's another reform that will help bolster our economy and, again, rein in some of these unelected bureaucrats that have been causing so much harm to our economy. But there are a lot of other important priorities, too. And I think when you look at where we are, this is a good step to start the next budget process to where we can actually shift our priorities into the things that we want to focus on to create jobs and get America working again. Now I want to talk about health care. You know, we've been making important progress on this bill that actually repeals and replaces Obamacare and puts patients back in charge and lowers premiums in the healthcare marketplace that is failing in a very dismal way right now. There's a tailspin in the healthcare marketplace because Obamacare has failed the American people. And I want to talk a little bit about pre-existing conditions because that's come up a lot. Our bill protects people with pre-existing conditions, and it actually provides multiple layers of protection for people with pre-existing conditions in ways that Obamacare doesn't do. First of all, by having the ability for people with pre-existing conditions to have continuous coverage as the rule of the land across the country, no matter what happens, and then if a state wants to request a waiver, even if that state requests a waiver and gets a waiver, a continuous coverage is still the law of the land, can't be waived for people with pre-existing conditions. On top of that, in the state's waiver, they actually have to lay out how they're going to protect people with pre-existing conditions. And they have to show that they have a high-risk pool to protect people with pre-existing conditions. So all of those layers are in place to protect people with pre-existing conditions in our bill, which focuses on reducing cost while protecting people with pre-existing conditions. But let's look at Obamacare, because there's this assumption that Obamacare actually does protect people with pre-existing conditions. So I asked my own constituents, just like I did when Obamacare was moving through Congress back in 2009, before we had our 27.5-hour markup in energy and commerce, I did the same thing. I reached out to my constituents in Southeast Louisiana, and I said, share with me your stories. And I got a number of stories from people with pre-existing conditions who are being hurt by Obamacare. And I want to read one of them right here. Chris from Slidell wrote to me, I have a pre-existing condition. ACA insurance is outrageously priced with huge deductibles. It has been cheaper for me to pay out of pocket for two surgeries, all other medical expenses, and the ACA penalty rather than to purchase insurance and still have to cover a large deductible and copay. My prescription costs have skyrocketed. My husband is covered by the VA, but I don't qualify for any coverage. We are being penalized for working and taking responsibility for our own expenses. ACA has cost me thousands of dollars with not a damn thing to show for it. This is one of many examples that I've personally received of constituents with pre-existing conditions who are being hurt by Obamacare. Our bill actually stands up for patients like Chris and others so that they not only have protection for their pre-existing conditions, but they actually have lower premiums so they can have better choices for their family.
Good morning. This week, we will finish our work on the final appropriations bill from the budget. And it was a bipartisan effort for the Republicans. Our priorities were the certainty, the security, and the accountability. As you think about the importance of funding defense, that is the number one priority of the federal government, is to keep this country safe. And I'm proud this bill reflects that priority. It also increases pay for our military, which is really important. It provides security funding for our border. For me, I'm pleased to see the funding for NIH, which has been a Republican priority through 21st Century Cures, so that America will continue to be the leader. We need to be investing in that health research. I'm also pleased to see the funding for fighting forest fires, which is a continued threat in the West. But really, this allows us to go to work on this year's budget, which is our opportunity to really change the course. Balancing budgets, reversing what we've seen in the deficit spending, really going after reauthorized spending, rethinking the federal government from top to bottom, every program, every agency, so that we do have an efficient, effective, accountable government. I'm also very excited to see us moving forward this week on the Working Families Flexibility Act. Very proud of the leadership of Martha Roby on this effort. She's gotten it further than anyone else. And as you think about empowering people, individuals, working men and women in America, I don't think there's anything more powerful than giving them more control over their time so that they can make the best decisions for themselves and their families. And I'm really excited we're moving forward with it.
Does anyone have any questions? Chad.
Good morning. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Morning.
Two-part question. Did the president hurt your effort on health care yesterday? And number two, are you losing this argument about pre-existing conditions? Mr. Scalise addressed that, but it seems like even if there are misperceptions, that it's hard for you guys to win that back.
Not at all. The president's been nothing but helpful on health care. He's been very helpful on health care. He's helping with a lot of our members. And as Mr. Scalise mentioned, there are a few layers of protections for pre-existing conditions in this bill. What's important is we want to have a situation where people can afford their health insurance. We want to have a situation where people have a choice of health insurers. That's not happening in Obamacare. Remember, over 1,000 counties in America have only one health insurer to choose from, a monopoly. And those people are getting cranked with high premium increases, double-digit premiums increased last year, even bigger ones being predicted for this year. So what good is insurance if you don't get it, if it's not offered to you, or you can't afford it? So the purpose of our bill is to get more choices, to lower prices, while preserving the protections for pre-existing conditions. So that is a very important thing. We're excited about this policy. We're making very good progress with our members, and our president has been instrumental in that. Yeah, Christina. How many times have I had this? Do you agree with the tweet this morning? You're talking about September? Look, we've got a long ways to go between now and September, but I share the president's frustration. What a lot of people in America don't realize is appropriation bills, they take 60 votes to pass. They can be filibustered. And so all appropriation bills, therefore, have to be bipartisan because Democrats can always filibuster an appropriations bill. Having said all of that, I feel very good about the wins that we got with the administration in this bill. Look, I negotiated the first Murray-Ryan agreement a number of years ago. Under the Obama rules, you had, if you wanted to help the military, if you wanted a pay raise for the soldiers, if you wanted to buy new airplanes and new ships and more munitions, a dollar for that, you had to have a dollar domestic spending. We just broke that parity. That's the biggest victory we could have had. $25 billion year over year for our military to begin to rebuild our military without that kind of corresponding increase in domestic discretionary spending. So that, to me, is very important. But look at the other conservative wins we have in here. Our pro-life riders preserved. School choice advanced. We're fixing things like forest fires and the disasters that we have. And we're giving the Border Patrol the kind of increases they need. We knew we needed a big down payment on border security. We knew that with a five-month bill, the wall is really more about next year, and that fight's going to be this summer. But we wanted to get the administration a really good down payment on border security. And that's why this bill has the biggest increase in border security funding in 10 years. So we think these are really good wins. I know that there's a PR machine that the Democrats are pushing. I'd say don't look at the press releases, look at the bill. And when you look at the bill, there's a lot of good conservative wins here. But chief among them are the president's two highest priorities. Support our military and get border security, get a down payment on border security, and this delivers that.
Last question.
Yeah.
Mr. Speaker, conservatives expressed disappointment, though, that Planned Parenthood still remains funded.
Planned Parenthood is not funded.
But there hasn't been a new funding.
So we... Sure. So, so you don't even have to ask my question if you're answering my question. You're getting there. Okay, I'll give you. Let me just say a couple of things. And look at what all our pro-life groups are saying. They're saying the Planned Parenthood legislation needs to be in the reconciliation bill as it is, because that's how you get it into law. We always knew that it takes 60 votes to pass an appropriation bill through the Senate. This bill does not have funding for Planned Parenthood. That's important. The reconciliation bill advances the pro-life cause even further. So no Planned Parenthood funding in here. And by the way, Tom Price is now the person who approves grants that go out to the states. So we feel very comfortable that we are working hand in glove with an administration to advance our pro-life priorities. So I'd say, number one, they're advanced here. We keep all our Hyde Amendment riders. And then our reconciliation bill, that's the bill that you don't need 60 votes on. That's the bill that you don't need to have Democrats with, and that's the bill that we're advancing our cause even further. And that is why these two efforts in conjunction with one another advance our cause and our principles quite a bit. Thank you. Thank you.
Is there a healthcare vote this week?
Leader, when are you going to vote?